Hey kids, come on over here. I want to show you something. This is a picture of my mom. She's in heaven now, but when she was still with us here on earth, she had the reputation of being the best, amazing cook. Everybody loved her cooking. I used to say, Mom, I sure hope Jesus put you in charge of the marriage supper of the Lamb when we all get to heaven, because you'll be the best cook there. This is a picture of her with one of her favorite famous meals. This was her famous turkey that she used to cook all the time. It was delicious. And then she'd make the mashed potatoes and gravy and the green bean casserole and the cranberry sauce and the fresh rolls and the pumpkin pie and, oh, the pumpkin pie. She tried her best to teach me how to bake and cook. But when I was growing up, I just wasn't interested. Now that she's gone on to be with Jesus, I've had to learn how to cook. I'm not bad, but I'll never be as good as my mom. But I have gotten a little bit better at making things like cookies and cakes and cupcakes and pies and so on. However, I have to follow the recipes very closely or they won't turn out so good. I have to measure everything, every ingredient, just the way mom's recipes tell me to, measuring the right amount of flour, baking soda, sugar, all the rest of it. I do my best.
It's Power Verse time, and today's verse comes straight down the court to us from the Bible in the book of Romans chapter 12, verse 3. It says, "Think with sound judgment, according to the measure of faith God has distributed to every man." Now repeat it after me. Think with sound judgment, according to the measure of faith God has distributed to every man.
Hi, my name is Paul and I am 9 years old. Romans 12, 3. Think with sound judgment, according to the measure of faith God has distributed to every man. Romans 12, 3.
Romans 12, 3. Think with sound judgment according to the measure of faith God has distributed to every man.
Great job! Let's try it one more time. Romans 12, 3. Think with sound judgment according to the measure of faith God has distributed to every man.
My name is Kennedy and I am 11 years old. Romans 12, 3. Think with sound judgment according to the measures of faith God has distributed to every man.
Awesome, Job! This reminds me of the game I played last week. For me, that means not just celebrating the win, but thinking about who got you there. Now that is sound judgment. I had hours of practice, pep talks from my coach, support from my teammates, but the truth is, I could not have done it without God. He gave me the strength and I trusted in Him. Even though I heard those cheers from the sideline, when I hit that three-point winning shot, all cheers truly go to Him. There is no way that I can think so highly of myself that I forget what He did for me. Now that's what I call a true three-point shot. Continue reciting your power verse, and remember, don't just be a listener of the word, do what it says.
You know, the Bible says that having faith in God is very important. It says we all have different measures or amounts of faith. What we believe and expect God to do for us depends on how big of a measure of faith we have. That's because each of us is growing in the Lord at different rates. Some of us grow in the Lord faster than others, kind of like different plants in your garden, or like kids growing up. Everyone grows at a different rate. That's why I love working with kids, because they seem to have big faith at young ages, whereas a lot of us grown-ups, we really have to work at it. Jesus, on the other hand, was different than us. The Bible says that Jesus had the Spirit of God in Him without measure. Or we could also say He had the faith for healing and miracles without limits. He had the unlimited God kind of faith. That's why everybody He prayed for got healed, and why He was able to perform all kinds of miracles, signs, and wonders. But us? not so much. Like me not being as good of a baker or a cook as my mom was. There was only one place where Jesus could not perform any miracles, and that was in his own hometown. The reason was the people there did not have faith in Jesus to do those miracles. They did not believe. Did you catch that, boys and girls? Faith must be a pretty big deal. If we have faith, we can see miracles. But when we don't have faith, even God can be limited in what he can do. Now, for sure, God is sovereign. That means he can do anything he wants, whether we have faith or not. But for the most part, it's very important that we grow our faith to have the same God kind of faith that Jesus did. But even in spite of us not having a huge amount of faith, God still loves to use us people to do miracles. Tell me, have you ever seen a miracle?
Hi, I'm Zanny, and I'm 9 years old. One Sunday, I saw a lady who was getting ready to leave the church. I asked if I could pray for her. She said I should pray for her daughter because her daughter was sick and was having trouble breathing. I prayed for her, and that Wednesday, she said that the doctor said that she was supposed to die, but now somehow she was healed, and the doctor took the machines off of her, and she went to the grocery store. That just goes to show how powerful God is and that God can do anything.
So, while we were at church, my friend Brianna, she had warts for a really long time, and she told everybody.
Where were the warts?
They were all over her hands, and
on the front, on the back, like
all over her palms and her hands.
Okay.
And fingers.
Okay.
And she told everybody that she had to hide her hands. So, and then during praise and worship, she had this cool vision of her lifting her hands, and then she heard this voice coming from her hands that was saying, "Be gone," and her warts were gone. And she told that to our children's pastor, Pastor Steve.
So she was having a vision. She was seeing that her warts were gone, but they weren't gone on her hands in real life.
Yeah.
Okay. And then she told Pastor Steve. Okay.
And then we made a group of people praying over her. And something really cool is I was putting my hands on her. I felt the warts as they were dissolving and they were shrinking.
I saw them disappear with my own eyes.
Hey kids, it's time to praise the Lord. Everybody on your feet and let's dance and sing and clap our hands.
Hosanna, oh, oh, Hosanna. Hosanna, oh, oh, Hosanna. Hosanna, oh, oh, Hosanna. Hosanna, oh, oh, Hosanna. Clap your hands.
The Bible tells the story about a man who was paralyzed. Being paralyzed means that he couldn't walk or use his legs. Jesus was going from town to town performing miracles, and he ended up going to someone's house to rest. But when people found out he was there, so many came that no room was left, not even outside the door. They wanted to see Jesus do a miracle. Four men heard that Jesus was in town, and they decided to carry their paralyzed friend on a mat to him to see if their friend could be healed. But when they arrived, there were so many people they couldn't get in. So they decided to take him to the roof of the house and cut an opening in it big enough to lower the mat that the paralyzed man was lying on down to where Jesus was. These men were absolutely sure that Jesus would be able to heal him. They had huge faith for a miracle. Otherwise, they wouldn't have gone to so much trouble. Jesus first forgave the paralyzed man of his sins. Then he said to him, "Take up your mat and go home." And the man did. Can you imagine how happy he was? The crowd was amazed and praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this."
The power of God is an amazing thing. No other religion or God can do what our God can. Some of them can try to imitate his miracles. Just like when Moses stood before Pharaoh in Egypt in the Bible, and God told him to cast down his rod to the ground and it turned into a snake. But Pharaoh's magicians did the same thing. It was like they had the same power Moses did. How does that work? But aha, Moses' snake just turned right around and ate up all their snakes. So you see, the devil does have power, but it's no match for the power of our God. Some people, even Christians, think that God and the devil have equal strength and ability. But the truth is, Satan is no match for our God. Today, God is using boys and girls just like you to do miracles, signs, and wonders all over the world, in every nation. In just a few minutes, I'm going to give you some very important keys to doing more and more miracles in your life. But we're going to do it in a very unusual way that you don't hear very many people mention. So before we do that, let's see if there's any more testimonies about children healing a sick person in the name of Jesus.
Hey there, my name is Chris, and I have an awesome story to tell you. It's a testimony of a six-year-old boy who was just here 2 weeks ago, right where I'm standing in these altars. And the night before, on Saturday night, he had fallen into a fire pit, and he had gotten burned really badly on his hand and on his back. And he went to the emergency room, and they had him all bandaged up. Well, his mom brought him to church on Sunday morning, and we all stopped the service and just prayed for him right here in the altars. But not just the adults, the kids, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10-year-old kids rallied around this little 6-year-old boy who had got burned. His name was Angel. And then we prayed for him, and guess what happened? The very next day on Monday, his mom sent us a picture, and he was completely healed. The burns were gone, and right now he is absolutely like it never happened. So we want to share some video clips of the kids praying for him, that you would be encouraged in your faith.
Get up, and all of a sudden he just flew backwards into the fire. And I was like, it's just a split second thing. And he starts screaming. And then all of a sudden he's flying out of the fire and he's running around with stuff all over him. And Bethany comes running out. She hears him screaming. And I'm trying to put Naya down and get to him. You know, it's this crazy scenario. And we know he's burned really bad. And so of course we take him to the ER, and they said he has deep second degree burns on his hand and on his back. But so, you know, none of us got to bed to 2 o'clock last night, and I'm thinking nobody's going to church today. Well, I woke up and the Lord said, "You need to take him to church and get him prayed for. I want to heal him."
Now you kids can pray too, okay? The same Holy Spirit that's in the adults is in you. And you guys can pray for Angel. So Angel, we're just going to pray for you, buddy, and ask God to heal you, okay? So Father, in the name of Jesus, we speak complete healing and restoration to this physical body. Every burn be healed. In the name of Jesus, new skin grow. Any damage be reversed to where when he gets older, you won't even know that it happened. You won't even see it. Father, heal this child for the glory of God. One of you kids want to pray over him?
I want to.
You want to pray? Okay, here. You just pray over him.
God, we pray for Angel to have no more fire on his hand and back. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody else want to pray? You want to pray? You guys' prayers are powerful.
Lord, I pray that Angel gets better and he doesn't hurt anymore and that doesn't happen to him anymore. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Jesus, that's good, buddy.
God, we just want you to heal this boy in the name of Jesus, because he fell into fire, but the angel saved him. And we just want to thank you, Lord. And we just need this boy to be healed in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
I want to talk to you today about healing sick people in the name of Jesus. This is something that's very important to God because he hates it for people to be sick. Every time Jesus went about healing people in the Bible, whether it was lepers or blind people or crippled people or something else, he would always finish by saying, "The kingdom of heaven has just come unto you." See, Jesus taught the disciples to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." That means that God wants to use us, you and me, to bring his kingdom to people on this earth. In his kingdom, there's no sickness or disease or broken bodies of any kind. So when we allow the power of God to flow through us and to heal people, that's just one way we can help him bring his kingdom to this earth. So how do we do that? Oh, there's so many things I would love to teach you about healing sick people in the name of Jesus. In fact, I wrote this great big book for parents and for kids pastors to teach kids just like you what the Bible says about healing. But I only have time to teach just one part of one lesson. So here it is. It's all about faith. We need to have faith to heal the sick. You see, there's two kinds of faith that the Bible talks to us about. One kind of faith is called the measure of faith. The other kind of faith is called the gift of faith. We need one or the other one of these types to heal sick people. So I want to talk to you about the measure of faith, because the Bible says all of us have a measure of faith. Do you know what it means to measure something? I'm sure you've seen your grandma or your mom or an aunt or somebody, maybe your dad likes to cook, and they've taken measuring cups like this to help them measure out exactly how much ingredients they need to put in their recipe. For instance, if they want to bake a cake, how much sugar do they need? How much flour do they need? And then there's something called a tablespoon. You've got a tablespoon, you've got an 1/8 inch cup, you got a 1/4 inch cup, a 1/2 inch cup, a 1/3 cup, a full cup, and wow, if something that could even hold 2 cups, that's a lot of flour and a lot of sugar. Well, we can use all these measuring cups to help us understand what a measure of faith is. See, faith isn't something that we can see with our eyes like sugar, but according to the Bible, it can still be measured. When a Christian is young in the Lord, which means they haven't been a Christian for very long, or we could say even a child who is young, and they are just learning about what the Bible says about healing and miracles, they probably just start out with a tablespoon of faith. Remember, everybody has faith. Some people just have more than others. So when it comes to praying for sick people, we need faith. But when we only have a little bit of faith like this, we might not always see everybody healed that we pray for. So we need to practice. Yes, I said practice, because like anything else, you need to practice to get good at something. You see, practicing in this way means praying for a lot of sick people, using whatever measure of faith you have to start with, even if it's just a little bit. You might pray for 100 people with your little tablespoon of faith and none of them get healed. But you don't give up, because then all of a sudden, one day, you pray for someone and right before your eyes, they get healed. Wow! And all of a sudden, your little tablespoon of faith grows to an eighth cup of faith. Oh, and it makes you want to pray for even more people. And it goes on and on. You pray for more people and your little eighth cup turns into a quarter cup of faith. And over time, you see more and more people healed. And all of a sudden, your quarter cup of faith turns into a half cup of faith. And soon, that grows to a whole cup of faith. And wow, you just see more and more people getting healed all the time. And someday, you might even get a two cup, a measuring cup of faith. Boy. That kind of faith just might raise the dead. But unfortunately, there's a lot of grown-up Christians who pray for just one or two people with their little tablespoon of faith, and when they don't get healed, they start backing off. Oh, they start making excuses like, well, God just doesn't heal everybody, you know, and we don't know why, but it just must not have been His will to heal that person. The only problem is they can't find any scriptures in the Bible to back that thinking up. No, the problem is they just never persevered to grow their measure of faith bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger so that more people would get healed. You see, a lot of times people will take their little quarter cup of faith and they'll try to go out and heal somebody who's dying of cancer. They might try to pray that a crooked back straightens up perfectly, but they've never developed their faith for those kinds of healings. And that's why you need to pray for lots of people and never give up. Because the more people you pray for, the greater chances you're going to see miracles. Remember, we all have a measure of faith, but we all have a responsibility to make that measure grow. Now, the second kind of faith is called the gift of faith. And the gift of faith is super, super special. Any Christian can have it, but only when God chooses to give it to him. And we never know when that might be. The gift of faith is amazing because God sometimes chooses a people with just a little tablespoon of faith to do something gigantic, and they just drop this giant gift of faith on them, and all of a sudden, through nothing that they did on their own, they have this moment in time where they have amazing faith for something impossible. And they lay hands on somebody who's really, really sick, and they get healed. It was a special gift that God gives for a specific situation. And we don't know when He's going to give that gift. But that's the difference between the gift of faith and a measure of faith. We can't practice to get a gift of faith. That's just something God does and chooses on His own for whatever reason, and that we really don't know why He chooses some and why He chooses other. But we can practice for praying for sick people to grow our measure of faith bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, that's not the only thing about healing the sick. Remember, I can only teach you one thing in this short little sermon. There's other things that you need to learn about that as well, but this is one thing to help you understand. So here's one more little tip I'm going to share with you about what the Bible says that we need to do sometimes when we pray for sick people. It says that we need to lay our hands on them. Now that might seem kind of odd thing to do, so let me explain. When you have the Holy Spirit in you and on you when you've been baptized in the Spirit, and you lay your hands on a sick person, the supernatural power of the living God flows out of you and into that sick person. It's like connecting God to them. It's like this power stick. Have you ever played with one of these before? You see, if I just depend on my own strength and my own abilities, when I pray for someone, probably nothing's gonna happen. But when I become the connection between God and that person, by laying my hands on them, the power flows from me to them, or from you to them. You see, there's a greater chance when that happens that there's going to be healed. So I have a question for you. Do you want the Holy Spirit to use you to heal the sick in Jesus' name? I'm telling you, boys and girls all around the world are doing just that. See, there's no cookie cutter way to heal every person. Don't just assume you're supposed to pray for the sick the same way every time. Let me give you an example. One time I had a lump on my eyelid that wouldn't go away. The doctor said the only way to fix it was surgery, but I didn't want to have surgery. So at church, I asked the children to pray for me by asking God how they should do it. One little girl named Courtney walked up to me and asked me to take off my glasses, and she told me, "I'm supposed to rub your eyes." Strange, right? Well, I took my glasses off, and she did what she saw in her heart. And she didn't say anything. She didn't even pray for me. She just kept her eyes closed and rubbed my eye for about 5 minutes. It didn't look like anything happened. But a couple of days later, I looked in the mirror, and the lump was completely gone. In that same service, there was a lady who needed prayer because she would get migraine headaches all the time. So she told the children to pray and asked the Lord how we were supposed to minister to that lady. One little girl came forward and picked up a flag that we use for worship. For about 10 or 15 minutes, that little girl just danced quietly around the lady without ever laying hands on her or saying a word. She did what she heard God tell her to do. By the time she stopped, the lady was completely healed. Now here's what we're going to do. I'm going to turn on some worship music, and we're all going to close our eyes, and we're going to begin praying in the Spirit. Now, if you don't know how to do that, just pray the way you know how best for God to speak to you. Now, first, you're going to ask Him who it is that He wants you to pray for and why. Then look in your heart for the Holy Spirit to show you what to do. The people don't need to be in the room with you right now. They can be anywhere. But ask God who to pray for. Then ask Him to show you how to pray for them. He may say something to you, or He may show you a picture of whatever it is He wants you to do. But just pay attention to what He says or what He's showing you. Write it down if you think you need to. If your mom or dad or grandparents are with you right now, tell them what He has shown you, and then you and your family can decide how to carry it out. Then I'd like for you to write to me and tell me what God told you or showed you. Then tell me what happened as a result of you obeying Him.
Our God reigns victorious. He is faithful. See you.